Moments of Life, Part 4. And I wish to conclude this today, if possible. I wish to conclude. This message is taken from Psalm 103. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. Who forgives all your iniquities? Who heals all your diseases? Who redeems your life from destruction? Who crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies? Who satisfies your mouth with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles? Today, what I want to do today, I want to try to, I will use so much illustrations. I will give stories. I will give a certain history. Then I will try to explain the whole chapter 103 from verse 1 to 22. We have 22 verses. Try to explain and bring out some key things there. And then maybe if I have more time, give you more stories just to help explain these things. And I want to also focus on something very, very important, the veil, the cover, something that covers our eyes that really make people not to be able to give God the praise, give God the honor, give God the thanks that is due to God, or something that always make people to forget about the benefits, the goodness of God. And that veil, that curtain, that covering is when you lack contentment, discontentment. So I'm going to do a little bit on that to explain this message of the milestone moments of life. I am praying God that God will help us today so we can possibly conclude this message on that part four. Five main things God does all the time for his children. Five main things. God is, redeems, crowns, satisfies us. You know, God forgives all our iniquities, all our sins. And if we continue to forgive, imagine sins that we are committing today or that we have committed had been paid for even before we were born, when Jesus died on the cross of Calvary. So you can imagine that. So we continue to forgive. We continue to cleanse. We continue to heal us. We continue to redeem us. We continue to crown us. We continue to satisfy us with good things. So we want to thank God because God is always there to meet our need. Last part three, I told you that something is very common to every one of us, that is need. We all have need. All of us. We all have need. And put this at the back of your mind. Do not let your need cover the fact that you need to give God praise. We have to count our blessings. We have to count all God's blessings, all God's benefits in our lives. Count all his benefits. Forget not his benefits. Count God's blessings. Count God's benefits. Let us stop counting our needs or counting our problems. Some people, they count their problems. When they come before God, they don't count their blessings. They don't count all the benefits of God in their lives. It is not good. So, count. If you don't count God's blessings, if you don't remember God's benefits, then it's going to be very difficult for you to have that landmark moments and be able to record that moments in our lives. Praise the Lord. So let me start with this this whole time philosophical saying or things that people, a kind of illustration to let us see that somebody is better than you are better than somebody. You need something, somebody needs another thing. Something that you need, that you have achieved, someone else is looking forward to have that thing. So, I mean, we should just try as much as possible to see beyond what you have right now. Look back and be able to show God appreciation. Show God gratitude. Let's have spirit of gratitude to God for what he has done. And this story will go like this. This story is like this. And I want to kind of illustrate that story, then I will explain some of that things, then we continue and explain Psalm 103 in detail. A man with a cover cloth, just a piece of cloth, a cover cloth, wrapped around himself to just cover his nakedness, went to the river to take bath, to wash himself. I want to explain very well for those of you who may not understand some of these things. This man was with a cover, just a cover cloth, a piece of cloth that can cover him all night. So he went to the river to clean himself. So, just like a bed sheet, you know that, just having a bed sheet, wrap yourself around with that. So when he got to the river, he saw a man with a piece of cloth that he wrapped, that this man had a piece of cloth, we can call it, not a pant, but something like a skirt. No one could wear a skirt. So he saw that man with his skirt around him. The man that saw this other man with his skirt, he was having a bed sheet to cover all his nakedness to the river to take his bath, to wash. So as he got to the riverside, he saw another man with a skirt, just a skirt. The skirt just managed to cover his private part. This is not the kind of skirt you can just sit down. If you sit down, they may see his private part. This is just a skirt that just managed to cover, just to cover his private part. He saw that man also at the river to take his bath. Then this other man who wrapped himself with bedsheet said, "God, I thank you. I was just thinking that I don't have anything. I was complaining with this bedsheet I wrapped myself. But look at this one, just with a skirt. This one, if you just sit down, the skirt will just pull off and then they will all see the private part. God, I thank you because of this bedsheet you have given me to cover my nakedness." As he was saying that, one other man came to the riverside. That one was totally naked, stark naked, without anything. He also came to the riverside to take his bath, to wash himself. Then the man with his skirt around his waist, that just covers his private part, said, "God, I thank you because look at this one. This one is totally naked. I just thought this little one I have is not enough, oh God. But this is another one, naked, at the riverside, taking his bath." So as he was saying that, the man who was naked said, "God, I want to thank you because I'm alive. God, I am alive. There are people that are not alive. They may be prepared to be naked and be alive. But they are not alive. But God, I know that I don't have anything. I came to the riverside to wash myself, to clean myself, but one thing that I'm grateful to is that I am still living." And listen, when there is life, there is what? There is hope. We should be grateful to God. Somebody may be better than you, but you are also better than somebody. God is always better than all of us. So you cannot say, "Oh, I am just the best," or "I am better than everybody, so no one is better than me." That is not true. If there's no human being that is better than you, if that is your mindset, but listen to me very carefully, God is better than all of us. Amen.
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 Sometimes what we don't have might be the problem or the reason why we don't recognize the fact that we need to take record of the most important things, take record of the landmark moments of our lives. What we don't have. And so many people, we continue to dwell and concentrate and focus on their needs. And focus on their needs, which is a very bad thing to do. So I want you to begin to think about yourself, begin to organize yourself, begin to imagine yourself, and be honest with yourself. Do you count your blessings? Do you remember all the benefits of God in your life? Think about. Look, as we are still here today, or maybe you are listening to me, don't you think you have many things for you to be able to thank God? Even for the fact that you still have that need in your life, that particular need in your life, you still also have reasons to be grateful to God. Because God is a good God. Amen?
Amen.
God is a good God. The milestone moments of life. If all of us can stop to focus on our needs and continue to focus on the benefits of God, the goodness of God, the mercies of God, the grace of God, the favor of God that we receive, then we'll be able to take notice of all those landmark moments of our life, and we'll record it for the generations to come. But if we continue to focus on needs, continue to focus on the problems that we have, and fail to count our blessings, then we will lack to remember all those things, wonderful things that God has done in our lives. Are you getting my point now?
Yes,
I'm trying to make this as simple as possible. Now let me give you another illustration. Years ago, a man called Rosen Conwells told us an ancient Persian story. This man was called Ali. Story about Ali. Ali Hafed. And I want to listen very carefully. I'm trying to get it verbatim, so I don't miss the important aspect I want to tell you. Ali Hafed went to bed that night in one time. Ali Hafed, Rosset said Ali Hafed owned a very large farm. Very big farm. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
He owned a big farm that had horses, grain fields, and gardens. Very mighty, big one. And was wealthy, contented man. He was a wealthy man and very contented. He was satisfied with what he had, and he was enjoying it. But one day, a wise man came from the east to visit Ali. So the man who came from the east, the wise man, you know, sometimes we need to listen. We see some people as experienced people, wise people. We want to listen to them when they counsel us. We don't even want to weigh their counsel. We just think, oh, this is the great advice. This is wonderful. One day, this wise man who came from the east told the farmer, told Ali, all about diamonds. That wonderful, precious stone, diamonds. And how wealthy he will be if he can mine diamonds, if he can go into mining diamonds. A good business. So the wise man from this told Ali, if you can go into mining diamond, that would be a very great opportunity for you. So when Ali had this story, Ali went to bed that night as a poor person, because he was thinking all the time, of how he can mine diamonds. And all that he had, that big farm, was nothing to him. You know, one of the president of the United States said, content makes a poor man rich. This content makes a rich man poor. Or like, let me explain. That's how he said it. That president said it. But let me explain this way. Contentment makes a poor man rich. Discontentment makes a rich man poor. So because Ali was thinking of how he can mine diamond, that night he didn't sleep very well, because all he's thinking was to mine diamond. So he took a big step. He sold his farm. And he started looking, searching, traveling all over, craving, you know, all for diamond mining. He traveled worldwide, he traveled to many places all over the world to get, just to be able to locate somewhere he can start to mine diamond. He was doing this and traveling, all the money he got, spent everything, and then at the end of the day, he committed suicide. Now, according to Rosel on this story, the man that purchased Ali's farm, one day led his camel into the garden to drink water. As his camel put his nose into the brook, the man saw a flash of light from the sands of the stream. The man saw that flash of light. He pulled out a stone that reflected all the hues of the rainbow. The man had discovered the diamond mine of Gold Candle, the most magnificent mine in all history, the diamond of Gold Candle. And Ali remained at home and dug in his own garden. Then instead of death, he In a straight line, he would have had acres of diamonds. And then what he was thinking of mining, he would have just, you know, started, he would have just started mining. Right in that far that is sold to another person. You know, sometimes what we have may not be very important for us until we lose it. And we see the importance of it. Ali died, committed suicide because of lack of contentment. He was content at a point in time, but because somebody told him he can sell his farm and then, you know, I mean, he can mine diamond and diamond will give him more money. Then he started to crave for diamond mining, looking for diamond, not knowing that that same diamond was in his farm. Psalm 103. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. Who forgives all your iniquities? Who heals all your diseases? Who redeems your life from destruction? God redeems our life from destruction. Who crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies? Who satisfies your mouth with good things so that your youth is renewed by the eagles? The Lord executes righteousness and justice for all who are oppressed. If somebody is oppressing anyone, don't think you are doing it for free. Or don't you think that nobody is watching? God is watching. And God is ready to revenge for that oppression. God is God. He will not let any of us pass through such a terrible, you know, experience without taking vengeance. He made known his ways to Moses. He had to the children of Israel. Verse 8, the Lord is merciful and gracious. The Lord is so merciful. God is so gracious. Slow to anger and abounding in mercy. If God is not slow to anger, so many people will have been destroyed. Some people will be asking me. Sometimes I talk to people, they ask me, they said, this person that is so wicked, that has been doing this against me, why is this person not being, judged by God? We thought that that judgment should be instant or should be now from our own thinking. But God knows how to take care of everything. God is so slow to anger. Before God can be angry against somebody, God has given a lot of chances for that person to repent. Very slow to anger. Abounding in mercy. The mercy of God is so abounding, it's sufficient. It's abundant mercy. He will not always strive with us. God will not, wrestle with us. God will always appeal to us to change. He will be appealing to us to repent. Now, will he keep his anger forever? If God is angry now, I'm telling you, in a very short term, God will just forgive and God will forget. God will cleanse. He will not keep his anger forever. Psalm 103. It's like a Bible on its own. And David wrote this at the tail end of his life, when he can look back to all that God has done to, in his life, and then be able to appreciate God. Verse 10, he has not dealt with us according to our sins. You know that? If God will deal with all of us according to our sins, I don't know if we should be alive today. He will not deal with any of us according to our behaviors, according to our attitude, according to our sins, because he's merciful, he's gracious. Nor punish us according to our iniquities. I think you all believe that. If God is going to punish us according to our iniquities, I'm telling you, no one is going to stand. No one will stand. Verse 11. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his mercy toward those who fear him. You know the distance, can measure the distance between heaven and earth. You can try to measure maybe the distance between the first heaven, the second heaven, or maybe the first heaven to the firmament, or the heart to the first heaven. You cannot measure the heart to the third heaven. You can't measure that. You don't know. You don't even know. Do you know who knows the seat of God? Nobody has discovered that. So as far as that is a mystery, as long as that continues to be a mystery, also, for as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his mercy toward those who fear him. The mercy of God is great. If you fear God, you will continue to abound in his mercy forever and ever. It's not something you can measure. It's not something you can calculate. As far as the east is from the West. East from the West, depending on which kind of East we are talking about and West we are talking about. So you cannot mention that. It's going to be difficult to mention. So far as he removed our transgressions from us, wide, he has removed it. Your transgression is so far away from you. It's gone. Some are gone forever. If you confess your sins, you will prosper. Only when you cover your sin. So anyone that covers sin will not prosper. But anyone that confesses his sin, we do what? We have mercy. It's far away. Our transgression is so far away from us. Verse 13. As a father pities his children, so the Lord pities those who fear him. For he knows our frame. You know that? God knows our frame. He knows how fragile we are. He knows how much we can break down. He knows our breaking point. The milestone moments of life. God is a good God. He's gracious. God is a wonderful God. And I just pray, God, that the Lord will grant us more understanding to see how much opportunity we have to have God as our Father. He knows our frames. He remembers that we are dust. You know that? We are dust. As for man, his days are like grass, as a flower of the wind, so he flourishes. For the wind passes over it, and it is gone, and his place remembers it no more. You know, I wonder if God would make our days to be like a flower, to be so short like that. If God would make our days, the days of our lives, if God should make it to be everlasting, the days of our lives in this world to be everlasting. Do you know what that means? In this wicked world, in this world of pollution, in this world of dangers, of you know, so many bad things happening, for somebody to live here forever, do you know what that will mean? So God makes the days of our life very short because we cannot stand all these sufferings. All these sufferings, we cannot stand it. God made everything so short because of his love for us. And he's waiting to receive us to eternity where we'll live forever, not in this wicked body. And so each time I remember what you know God did in the garden, I want you to mark this in your Bible very carefully. What God did in the garden. When our father and our mother sinned in the garden, and God pronounced judgment on them, and they became like us. I mean, they became like us. They know bad from evil. They can do anything, you know. So God thought in his heart that if I allow man to continue to stay in the Garden of Eden, do you know that because of his mercy, because of his grace, he wouldn't have sent us out of the Garden of Eden. You know that? Because of his mercy and his grace, because he loved us so much, he wouldn't have sent us of the garden. But for the fact that his mercy and his grace overcome the pleasure we have in the garden. And the God does not want us to remain as a sinner forever. If you read Genesis 3 from verse 22, Genesis 3 from verse 22, before we continue, verse 17 of 103. Genesis 3 from verse 22. Don't forget, we just stop on verse 16 of Psalm 103. But quickly, let us read Genesis 3 from verse 22. Then the Lord God said, behold, the man has become like one of us, in knowing good and evil. Now, let him reach out his hand and take also of the tree of life and eat, and live forever. In that state of sin, in that state of wickedness, in that state of rebellion, in that state of disobedience, is for him to remain like that forever, lest he will eat the fruit of life and remain in that state of disobedience forever, in that state of wickedness forever, in that fallen world forever. Do you know what it means to have life sentence? To remain in the fallen state forever. For human beings to remain in fallen state forever. To remain in the world of wickedness forever. To remain in disobedience against God forever. Do you know what that means? And because God loves us, God wouldn't want that to happen. He knows our frame. He knows that we are dust. So God determined to ensure that we will not eat from the fruit of life. So that we will not remain like that forever. So that we'll be able to have opportunity to repent and come back home for eternity. Then, what did he do? Verse 23. Therefore, the Lord God sent him out from the Garden of Eden to walk the ground from which he was taken. He drove out the man, and at the east of the Garden of Eden, he placed the cherubim and a flaming sword that turned every way to guard the way to the tree of life. Because man is stubborn. Look at what God did. God sent us out of the Garden of Eden so that we will not take the fruit of life. The reason for taking the fruit of life would have been that if you take the fruit of life, you will not die again. Amen? You will not do what? You will not die again. And God does not want us to remain in this state of wickedness, in this body, fallen body, and live forever. So, he didn't want us to eat that fruit. So, he drove man out of the Garden of Eden and then placed a cherubim with a sword because man is stubborn. Why? Man can go back again to the garden. Because man is now living in the state of disobedience. So man can go back to the garden. And God does not want to take chances. He did not only send us out of the garden, he placed a cherubim at the gate of the garden so that we're not going to go inside there. The cherubim is going to do what? Fight and guide the garden. So that we have the opportunity to repent. So that we have the opportunity to give our life to Christ, so that we have the opportunity to come back home and live forever with the Lord. Not in this state of wickedness, not in this state of disobedience, not in this state of suffering. So we'll come back home with a changed state, with a changed body, and then live forevermore, and then have access to this, to the tree of life. Is God not awesome? Hello? Is God not good?
Yes,
that's why the psalmist said it. The Lord is good. All the time, forever, God is good. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. So, we should always bless the Lord with all, everything within us. Everything within us should bless the Lord. And we must not forget all his benefits. Let's go to verse 17. But the mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting on those who fear him. God's mercy is from everlasting unto everlasting. God's mercy is forever. God's mercy is eternity. God's mercy will never end. Do you get what I'm talking about? God's mercy will not end. It's going to be forever. It's going to go from everlasting to everlasting. His mercy will endure forever. But on those people who fear him. And the fear of God is the beginning of all wisdom. To fear God, look at what the next verse we see now. And his righteousness to children's children. Look at verse 18. To such as keep his covenant. So if you fear God, you do what? You will keep his covenant. Psalm 103. Loaded. And to those who remember his commandments to do them. So when you fear God, you remember his commandment, and not just remember his commandment, you remember his commandment to do them. If you fear God, you are not only going to listen to God's word, you will have the desire to do what you are hearing, to do them. And that is so important. That's what is called to fear God. We are not just fearing God when we just hear the word and we just push it aside or we just wash it with our hands. You fear God when you keep that covenant, when you keep that commandment, to do them, when you have desire to do what we are listening to, then the fear of God is there for you. Verse 19, the Lord has established his throne in heaven and his kingdom rules over all. The kingdom of God rules over all. Bless the Lord, you his angels, who exert in strength, who do his word, heeding the voice of his word. Bless the Lord, all you his hosts, you minister of peace, who do his pleasure. Bless the Lord, all his works, in all places of his dominion. Bless the Lord, O my soul. That is just the summary of Psalm 103. Hello? I remember it was Benjamin Franklin that said that content makes poor man rich. Discontent makes rich man rich men poor. Benjamin Franklin. Poor man. Contentment will make him rich. Contentment will make him count all his blessings. Will make him not forget the benefits of God in his life. For rich man, this content, we do what? We always make rich men poor. Because you'll be looking forward for how to know, to have more and more. And I want to give you more stories and things like that so we can understand these things. I see I have some few more time I want to spend with you. I just want to understand this message very carefully. The milestone moments of life. Please, we need every moment of our life to count our blessings. Let us be grateful to God. Let us appreciate God. Let us thank God. When you listen to news, the one who was leading the best person who was leading the prayer I was listening to this morning was saying about disasters happening around us. Natural disasters happening around us, in what? Happening everywhere. And God has been sparing you. People have been traveling, you've traveled so far and near, God has been protecting you. No joy is so small. God has been protecting you, God has been sparing your life. Some of us, only little things that we see want God to do for us, will cover us, will become like a cloud. And will make us not to even appreciate God at all. It's out of wickedness not to appreciate God. This is every moment of our life, the Lord is good. Every moment, the Lord is good. The Lord, every moment of life. I have no reason to regret having Jesus as my Lord and my Savior. Because he watches over me. God is not going to... I mean, look at what that Sam said. As Father Peter's his children, so God also. He pamper us. Sometimes God will pamper you. Sometimes God will just give you something that we ask him to give you, which you don't even need. Something you don't need, God will just give you. Just to make you feel good. Look at the Israelites. I was wondering, why should God allow them to have a king? I mean, when they went to God and said, God, give us a king to rule over like other nations. And Samuel thought they had rejected him. And God said, no, they had not rejected you. These people have rejected me. Who they said they don't want me to rule over them. That's what they do. If they should come to you and tell you, give us a king to rule over us like other nations. Listen to them. Give them that king, but tell them what that king is going to do to them. But God desired to let them have it because they have self-will. God desired to let them have it because God is just trying to pamper them. God is just trying to make them have whatever they want to have. Eventually, they will know that they don't even need it. Sometimes God will let you have what you are asking for, just to let you know that you don't need it. You just ask for it, okay? It doesn't cause any harm to God to give it to you, but it could cause harm to you. Sometimes God will restrain himself. We don't want to give it to you because he knows it can cost your life. Because of his mercy, because of his love, because of his loving kindness, he will just restrain you from having that thing. Sometimes God wants to show you some things, you don't get it, and he will hit you, allow sickness to hit you, so that you can easily listen, so you can turn to the side he wants to turn to. God is merciful, God is great. There is nothing that will happen to you if you are a child of God, if you are born again. I want to tell you, write this down. There is nothing that will happen to you without God's knowledge. Absolutely nothing. Even things that you brought upon yourself, God knows. He's a merciful God. Let's count our blessings. Look, the milestone moments of life. Those times that God will spare you when you're supposed to die, but he spared your life. There are things that you should put down, you should remember always. Those times that God delayed, God brought a delay into your life. A journey that will have caused you total destruction. God will just delay you, but you are not happy because of the delay you have. Maybe you want to go out somewhere with your friend is delaying, and you are just annoyed, not knowing that delay might be a blessing for you. He's a good guy. All the close calls. He's a good guy. Nothing is an accident for every child of God. That's why in the dictionary of Christians, born-again Christians, there's no word like unfortunately. Are you with me this afternoon?
Yes, sir.
Just relax, forget about whatever is happening around you. Forget about whatever is happening around you. Just relax, be happy. Your life is worth living, honestly. And every moment counts. And time flies. Lamb has wings and it's flying. So why do you want to spend this, the most important aspect of your life, the quality part of your life, why do you want to spend that sorrowful or thinking about something you don't even need and forgetting to count God's blessings in your life, forgetting all His benefits? Let me tell you one other thing we had in the history. In the 5th century, a man named Arenos determined to live a holy life. This is history. I told you I'm going to explain this thing with illustrations. You know, I just want to load you. I want you to remember, each time you're going out of that place, each time you are driving your car, each time you go to work and you come back home, don't account this on your own strength. It is the strength of God. It is the strength of God. So, this man, Arrhenius, determined to live a holy life. So like in the 5th century. So he abandoned the comfort of Egyptian society to follow an austere lifestyle in the desert. So he went to camp in the desert. Said, look, I'm going to leave this material-filled city and I'm going to stay in the desert. Yet, whenever he visited the great city of Alexandria, he spent time wandering through his bazaars. Asked why, he explained that his heart rejoiced at the sight of all things he didn't need. Seeing all these gadgets in the city, his heart rejoiced, I don't need this because I'm in the desert. If I get a car, how am I going to drive a car in the desert? If I get a motorbike, I'm going to drive. So I don't need all these things, I'm in the desert. No life, nothing in the desert, right? So he doesn't need all those gadgets. If he's going to listen to news, maybe he doesn't say they call something bush radio. Maybe he's going to do for bush radio. But he must get a good battery. When the battery fails, he has to go back to the city to buy one. That's why he explained that his heart rejoiced at the sight of all things he didn't need. Those of us who live in a society flooded with goods and gadgets need to ponder the example of the desert dweller. Those of us who live in the United States, those of us who live in a city, think about those who live in the desert. And this is what history said. They said in 1976, a typical supermarket in the United States, just 1976, a typical supermarket in the United States, this is statistics, stock 9,000 articles. Are you with me? We need to stop this rat race. Honestly, if not, you are not going to enjoy yourself. You are not going to count your blessings. You are not going to count all the benefits of God in your life. 9,000 articles in 1976, a typical supermarket in the United States. But today, what happened today? Today, it carries 30,000 articles. Today, it carries what? 30,000 articles. How many of them are absolutely essential? How many superfluous of articles that you need? How many of them are important? From that 30,000, imagine, in 1976, 9,000. Today, 30,000. You enter a typical supermarket to get 30,000 articles. How many of them will you need? There's this competition. People are competition. There's this new phone that came out. Galaxy 3 or something like that. Samsung. The corny people come and buy it, it's the best, iPhone, this and that. We have all this, this one is competition everywhere. I mean, you can imagine, but how many of them do we need? They are important, they are essential, but how many do you think you need? And they always say something in America, dream on. Keep dreaming. Do what? Keep dreaming. America, keep dreaming. But let me tell you something that I have here also as part of history. Post-war Americans always cherish the expectation that their standard of living would improve with each generation. That is their thinking. This story is got from, I think, it's statistics. This is statistics. And those things that are recorded, people, I will give credit to those who do those statistics as we continue these things. But just keep listening to me. I read these statistics. So, in pools, at the onset of Reagan era, they said through Reagan era, there was a pool. And they said two of every three respondents, those who responded to that pool, said they expected to be better off than their parents. Two of every three. During Reagan era. Now, that figure is being reversed. Almost three-fourths of 1,000 people who answered a Roper pool. This guy is given to Roper pool. For sharing the Lehman Brothers. Say, the American dream is harder to attain. Lehman Brothers say it's harder to attain American dreams. And those of you that possibly because of American dreams, you think that God is not essential. You think that you cannot count your blessings. You think that you don't have any landmark moments because you have not attained that dream. Think twice. And listen to what this statistic said to these Lehman Brothers. So it's harder to attain that dream more than a generation ago. And 60% say achieving the dream requires more financial risk. Do that statistic that to attain the American dream requires more financial risk than it did for their parents. And I want to tell you, it will continue to go up and up. The risk will continue to increase. To attain American dreams, our children, we have to take more financial risk. Do you know the credit card debt of an average American? I want to give you that assignment. You go and ask. Average American. You are not yet an American if you don't have credit card. Hello? Because America herself is living on credit. You get me now? It's on credit. Then you, member of that society, gee, you're going to survive without credit card? Spend it now, pay it in the future. Lay away. American dream. So when I got here, I had lay away. In this country, it's awesome. To survive in other places other than here may be tough. Except if they follow American system. I can buy this shoe and say, maybe after a month, before the end of a month, I don't like you. Don't look good. Take it off, go back to the store, give it to them. I don't need it. By law, I want them to do what? Pay me. Pay me back. Hello?
Hi.
And of course, that is a very, it's good. It has its own advantages, but it has some disadvantages. It's encouraging me to keep going to store. Keep going. Until you get the one that you will like most. Lord, help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
So, they said almost three-fourths of the 1,000 people who answer a Roper pool for shares with Lehman Brothers is harder, becoming more harder. Look at what the pool also finds. The pool also finds that some of the values held most dear during the 1980s. Those values, during the 1980s, in the 80s, they said people like to have wealth, to have power, and to have fame. They want to be wealthy, they want to have power, and they want to be famous in the 80s. But they said that nowadays, it's becoming so hard to attain that. And some people have committed suicide in getting that. People are now trying to relax on attaining that one, according to their pool. Now look at what they said now, before I go further. They said, for Americans with household incomes under $25,000, it's the Lehman Brothers pool, it would take $54,000 a year to fulfill the American dream. Over 50%. If you earn less than 25%, it will take you 50-something percent to attain American dream. So who will pay for the difference?
Those who make 100,000 plus claim an average of 192,000, almost 200,000, almost 50% of American dream. Those who make six figures, 100,000, they claim more.
Oh, we need to count our blessings. We are blessed.
Hallelujah.
You just look back and see how God has blessed you. All of you, you have, your children are good, they are healthy. Your husband, wonderful. Your wife, wonderful. Yourself, you work out. Can't we just appreciate God? Let's forget about all these things. I don't have this, I don't have that. I am not this, I am not that. I want to be this, I want to be that. Can't we just forget about all that and enjoy the one you have right now? And let's look at how they conclude the statistics. They said, American dreams nowadays, American dream usually lies nearly twice the distance away. Do what? Twice the distance away. There's nothing wrong in having an American dream, brethren. Nothing's wrong. But it's how you approach this thing I'm telling you now. If you continue to approach that dream without appreciating God and His benefits in your life, that is where we have problem. The Lord will bless you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Count your blessings, brethren. Stop counting your problems. Stop counting with your what? Don't keep counting your needs. Count your blessings. Name them one by one. It will surprise you for what God has done. He's a good God. You go to the washroom, you take your bath, you clean up, you put on your clothes, you walk out of the house, your brain is working normally. Great. I had a story. Somebody, a couple wrote a book. This job, by the way, and they have a theme on that book also. I'm going to look for it. It's called, I think, Vow, something like Vow. I don't know if you have heard it, if you have heard it, you've heard about the movie and the book. These people, they got engaged. I'll just tell you a little bit. I can't remember everything offhand. It just came to me. I didn't plan to tell you this, but just to let you know that we need to count our blessings. This couple, they got engaged. I think they married somehow like that. And they had accident somewhere in the United States. They had accident. Either in New Mexico, somewhere. And when they had that accident, the wife was nearly dead. They took her to the hospital. But you know what happened? They said she had what they call brain trauma. Not something that many people you understand what I'm talking about. They said through that trauma she had, her memory, part of it was wiped out. So eventually, she was treated in the hospital. She came back, but her husband was standing in front of her. She cannot remember her. I mean, remember him. They both had that accident, but she was most hit on that accident. She had a trauma. She forgot all the memory. She forgot when the man proposed. She forgot when they got them together. She forgot everything. Medical people, I think I'm not talking dream. It's something that can happen, right? He said that part of her brain was affected. That trauma affected that part of her brain that she cannot remember. Even she cannot recognize her husband. We have to bless God, brethren. You have to bless God. You have to appreciate God. God is good. God is the benefit of God in our life. They are countable. God, I appreciate you. And I will continue to mark those moments of my life that you spare my life. Me personally, I've had accidents, serious accidents, and I survived it. Can you imagine somebody coming out of a trauma and then you cannot recognize your wife? I'm going to look for that film and maybe I'm going to, we're going to have it together, show it together. God did a miraculous healing in that woman's life that she started all over again. They are now going from places to places. They are Christian born again. Don't think they are unbeliever. They got drunk. Not only when you are drunk, you get accidents. You can be the most righteous person that you can see have accidents. Rain fall on both righteous and unrighteous. We are all facing challenges. I am born again. I'm very righteous. In fact, ask my pastor, I pay all my tithes. That does not mean we don't face challenges. Don't say pastor is telling you that. You could face what? Challenges. Go and ask God. If you can see you when you get to heaven, he will explain to you. To cut the story short, Do you know that this couple, as I was listening to their story, they had to start all over again. They went to the man proposed again. The woman said, okay, if you are going to marry me, I don't know you. And the woman was saying that, the woman was saying that, if I could have taken decision to marry you, then you should be a good man. So when the man came in front, the woman first said, no. But then the man was trying to say, I will still marry you. Some men we took off. Because the woman has become like a liability now. Some men will do what? They will take off. Some men will take off. Sorry for my English. Sometimes we're excited. You can imagine. The man proposed again. Then they joined them. They went to church again for another. They joined them together again. They started all over again. Because the woman, even though now she had been hit, she cannot still remember the past. Was wiped out. Now you see, Sidan, some of you can remember when you are going to primary school, when you are 6 years old, you can still remember when you are. You can't do to if I say, thank God you can remember your childhood. Say, Pastor, what is normal? What is wrong in that? I'm not mad. Why can't I remember? I'm very smart. Something can happen that can wipe out your past. Find everything. You see your mother, you say, who is this woman? Who is this man? Somebody who trained you, somebody who lived with you. Look, the computer we carry around, this brain. God help us.
Amen.
It's great. It's God's mercy. It's God's greatness in our lives. Everything around this brain. You know, some people will touch hot stuff, they will know it's hot. Because they close that part that will tell, the brain will tell, it's hot. Move your hand. It's dangerous. That is gone. Lord bless you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
But you know that even people like that, they still have to do what? Thank God because they are alive. I see parents, I see them sometimes they will wheel their kids on their wheelchair. The kids will put bottle here, bottle there. They said they have they called all these things, they were born like. There was a time a woman went to somewhere in the United States, I read it. Went to a clinic or a public government hospital or something like that, abandoned a child and took off. Because the child is a liability and they were looking for her. Nobody wants to adopt that kind of person. They were looking for me. They were looking for her. They want to shag her for abandoning that child in the hospital. But she was tired. Can't you count your blessings? Can't you count God's benefits in your life? You can complain and say, my child is stubborn. And so what? Pray. God is going to shake him. He's better than some other problems, some other children. Can't you be grateful to God? I don't have $10. And so what? You have $1. Can't you do something with that $1 you have and be grateful to God? Look, let me tell you another one. Philip Parham tells the story of a rich industrialist who was disturbed to find a fisherman sitting lazily beside his boat. This was taken from Our Daily Bread. I have to give credit. You listen to me now. It was so far away. I was deliberating of May 18, 1994. If I can remember. By May 18 or May 26 or something like that. Why aren't you there fishing? So Philip asked him, let me start all over again. Philip Baham tells the story of a rich industrialist who was disturbed to find a fisherman sitting lazily beside his boat. Why aren't you out there fishing? He asked him. Because I have caught enough fish for today, said the fisherman. You caught enough fish for today. What do you mean by that? Emphasis added by me. Why don't you catch more fish than you need? The rich man asked. What will I do with them? The fisherman, explained back to the rich man. You could hand more money, came the impatient reply, and buy a better boat so you could go deeper and catch more fish. The industrialist was telling the fisherman. You could purchase nylon nets, catch even more fish, and make more money. Soon you have a fleet of boats and be rich like me.
The industrialist will say that. Then the fisherman asked, then what will I do? You could sit down and enjoy life, said the industrialist. Fisherman, if you can catch more fish and become very rich, you can sit down and enjoy life. Then the fisherman asked him, what do you think I'm doing now? The fisherman replied as he looked speedily out of the sea. What do you think I'm doing? What do you think I'm doing here now? So if I have more money, will I do better than this one? You don't even know that you are enjoying better than having more than you have. That if you even if you are even if you have access to million, you will not be enjoying as we are enjoying now. That's what that story is trying to tell us. Can't you count your blessings? Can't you count your blessings? Some of us we think it's greener over there. And some women have run into trouble because of this. They see this lover boy promising heaven and earth. I'm going to buy you this, buy you that. And as soon as you get into his trap, boom like that, the lover boy will change. I'm telling you, that man you have is the best for you. Enjoy him. That woman you have there, she's the best for you. Enjoy her. Stop doing experiments. You don't do experiments with men or with women or with wife. Don't experiment. They're human beings. Hello? Because you want to go back, may not be hard, you will not be easy to go back. Let us be happy. Let us just be happy. Rejoice in what God has given you. I don't know, maybe I should give you more. I have so many here. You want me to give you more before we pray?
Yes, sir.
Can't you count your blessings?
Oh, yes.
Will you now go over and be counting your blessings? Will you be thanking God for the family God brought you? See, there's some things you cannot change. Even if I continue to tell you story on story and story, I will tell you one, then we will pray. See, that will not make you to change. But this one thing I know. There's some things you cannot control. And those things are the veil, like a cutting fog in our eyes, not to let us be able to count our blessings and glorify God. You don't control the country you are born. You don't control that. You don't control who and who should give birth to you into this world. You don't control that. You don't control if you are going to be a man or a woman. You don't control that. God controls that, right?
Right.
It is true. Scientists say the chromosome X, the chromosome Y, the genetic chromosome this, chromosome this, and they become chromosome. Do you control those chromosomes or whatever they call them? You control them? You don't know when this is happening. So now you think, oh, why I would have been a white man? Why am I a black man? Why am I a blue man? Why am I a brown man? Why am I a short man? Why am I too tall like this? Why am I so fat like this? Why am I so thin like this? Why am I? Will not let you count your blessings. As to her, you are you and no one like you. You are distinct. You are special. And then you should be grateful to God and count all your blessings. You are the best. You are the best. In those days, before I gave my life to Christ, oh, yeah, no, you don't say I want to start all over again.
Speak,
I should speak it.
No.
If you say you are handsome, I will tell you I'm handsome too. Hello?
Yes.
You want to play again? I will tell you I can play it better.
Yes.
If you say you are taller than me, I will tell you I can do better than you. Though I am like this, I am the best.
Of course.
So it depends on how you look at it.
Absolutely.
Don't get defeated. Don't think that, oh no. Some of us, you remember when we were in the school those days? Look at some people, maybe they just have little advantage. They get more, maybe this 100%, and you are getting maybe like 90%. You understand what I'm talking about? And you're looking, I will have been like this. I'm like, some of them, after they finish from school, they may not do better than you.
That's correct.
Do you get me now?
Oh, yes.
They may not do better than you, and I'm going to tell you your destiny. Nobody can play it. You have to contribute and play your destiny.
Yes.
See, don't think that because somebody came from the family of Bill Gates, it can be better than you. No! That family you came from is the best family. Be proud of your family.
Yes.
Somebody was telling me, you know, a daughter came back and said, Daddy, I want to change my last name. Then the man said, why do you want to change your last name? Because they don't know how to pronounce my last name. I want to tell you something very carefully. God can make you to be important.
Amen.
Someone like me, where I work, the most time when I go work, because it is important to do what I have them to do, because government is asking them to do that, they must be forced to pronounce Adesanya. You must do what? I'm not going to change it. If you like to Adesanya, pronounce it. I'm not going to change it to George. I'm not going to change it to Lehman. I'm not going to change it to water or stone. It will remain Adesanya. And you must be forced to pronounce it if you want to get right with what I'm asking you to do. Amen? Some of us, we just unnecessary things like that. Look at God bless the President of the United States. Either you like it or not, you must be able to pronounce Barack Obama. Do you get me now? Now, you would have said to become president, I have to change my name. I have to change Barack to John. And I have to change Obama to James. So when they pronounce, they can vote for me. That is not the reason why they have to vote for you. If God destiny will vote for you, if you change your name from today to tomorrow, if God is not going to let it happen, it will happen.
That's right.
Count your blessings.
In them one by one.
Amen.
Yeah.
Don't be changing those things. Some people, they think that until they change, I'm not preaching hate crime. Some think until they change from man to woman before they can be important. They will not be changing. They will change from man to what?
Woman.
Some will use medication, hormone something, a man will be having a hot flash. A man having a, why do you put all this? Go and ask women, they will tell you what they're passing through. Before you get into that, God bless you, mothers.
Amen.
God bless you. One of them was talking here about the woman with issue of blood. And she was saying last week that, can you imagine to ever have it one day is a challenge? How much to have it for years? And some men, they want to have that. Hello? When our mothers are complaining, that if God can take that away. Some men, they want to have that. Some men, they want to carry body. They want to carry body here. It's not body, it's blessing. God bless you. It's blessing. It's God bless you. Hello? Do you see how human beings are not satisfied? They can't count their blessings. They can't appreciate God. And so women, you know, women are fantastic. See, men are made from organic materials. Women, mothers, are made from inorganic material, from refined material. God made man from the heart. And when God was to make human being, a man was asked to sleep, right? And God brought this from man, from the material made already. God brought man, woman out, and that's why they are beautiful. Can I continue?
Yes,
you don't use beautiful for a man. That's a mistake. A man is handsome. A woman is beautiful. Beautiful is super handsome. Beautiful. When they say the woman is beautiful. And that is why when we tell mothers, I know you are fantastic.
Yes, sir.
That's why when we tell mothers, help us. Don't let us get into trouble. A woman who is carelessly do like this on the altar, without just carelessly like this. A man's brain is whining. Hello?
Hi.
It is when this world became nonsense that men will be dancing for women to see. In most cases, men want women to do what? To dance, they want to see. They want women to just move around, they want to see. I have been in downtown, there have been times I'm going with my wife, especially when we are trying to go. I used to watch some men. When a man passes you and is looking back again, he's not looking back to look at you, man. He's looking back to look at who?
The woman.
No, the woman. Hello?
Hi.
And then, can you not imagine, for God's sake, For a woman to say you don't like that refined, inorganic material God made you and say you want to be like a man?
teaching me hate crime. I'm just expressing my heart, my feelings. Don't come and arrest me. What I'm saying is that the satisfaction will have God made you.
Amen.
Hey, children, don't ever dream it. I want to change my sex. No! You are the best! You are a woman, you are made from inorganic material. Refined material. Don't go back and become organic. And then change yourself. Change, remove. Some are very smart. Some are very wise. Some of them. They will not remove everything. So they can change their mind. Let us pray. Father, we thank you. Blessings this afternoon. We honor you for your mercy. We thank you for this wonderful time. Daddy, help us to count our blessings. Help us to count our blessings. Then we fail me to tell you all the stories I've heard of here. Then we fail me to tell you all the stories. A man was telling his wife that he wants to be rich and then be rich, and when he's rich, he will now buy golden plates. And as they were eating, they will now be eating in golden plates. And the wife asked him, what difference does that make? To eat on golden plates and to eat on ordinary plates. The same food. What difference would that make? It's all in the mind. Father, help us, oh God, to count our blessings and be grateful to you in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Help us, Lord Jesus, to appreciate you in our lives, in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
The milestone moments, that we'll be able to remember those landmark moments of our lives, in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
So that we'll be grateful unto you how you have made us. So that we'll be grateful unto you for what you have done in our lives.
Amen.
So that we'll be grateful unto you for what we have.
Amen.
Not what we have. In the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Blessed be your name, O God.
Amen.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.